thank you very much, Vaz, Professor Wolf, and distinguished members of the audience. It's a real pleasure to be back here in Tokyo, especially at this time of year with the cherry blossoms in full bloom. You know, the question that we've been asking is there any utility in looking beyond the posterior pole? And in this case, we're going to focus on retinal vein occlusion. You know, the treatments that we have available, whether that's anti-VEGF or steroid or even laser, it really focuses on the posterior pole. And hopefully what I'm going to be able to convince you of over the next few minutes is that there is some utility. When you look at the history of imaging, it's really a history of going beyond the posterior pole. We focused on the posterior pole because that's where really the business end is. People are interested in their vision. And in fact, our treatments have focused on this small area. Now that we're able to image the periphery, the treatments can be a combination of the peripheral treatment and the posterior pole treatment to maximize the patient's visual potential. Here's a patient that came to me with a superior visual field defect. Conventional fluorescein imaging shows you something that's occurring right there superior to the superior arcade. When you look at the ultra-wide field imaging, you can see this large area, wedge-shaped area of ischemia, secondary to a retinal vein occlusion. When this patient came to me, the vision was actually 20/20. So the presenting vision was not what brought the patient in. It was the visual field cut. And this visual field cut occurred a couple of weeks prior to the patient coming in to see me. This patient did go on to develop macular edema secondary to this vein occlusion. And what was my first treatment? My first treatment was anti-VEGF therapy. But after many anti-VEGF therapies, we ended up lasering this region here because the visual field defect was indeed still present, and it may have been driving the need for persistent anti-VEGF therapy to treat the visual acuity. Here's another patient, once again requiring repeated anti-VEGF injections. Very good response to anti-VEGF injections, but she just didn't like spending 2 hours with me every 4 to 6 weeks. What you can see out here is she actually went elsewhere for a second opinion, and that doctor did targeted peripheral panretinal photocoagulation. And she continued to require anti-VEGF therapy. Why is that? Well, that target may not have been hitting all the areas that are producing the VEGF. And so when we look at the retinal vein occlusion itself, that's really the business end that's affecting the vision. It's a small portion of the actual pathology that is present that may need to be treated in combination. Here's a patient with peripheral ischemia, once again with the vein occlusion, and the peripheral ischemia extends all the way up superiorly. And now going on to central vein occlusion. This is a patient that's courtesy of our colleague Mike Singer. You can see this particular image with the extensive areas of ischemia, not just the obvious ones that are in the temporal macula, because this you may be able to pick up with conventional imaging, but it's really out here in the superior retina, even in a nasal retina, if you look very, very carefully. And so the drive for macular edema, the drive for neovascularization here is very different when you take into consideration the superior, inferior, and nasal retinas. Here's a patient that's courtesy of Dave Brown. And once again, I will show you the ones that are very, very scary, and this is very, very scary. You know, here, the goal, I think, is only secondarily to maintain the patient's vision. The goal here when you speak with this particular patient is to explain to them the extensive area of ischemia, the severe, severe ischemia that may lead, and in this case most likely to lead, to the complications that we see from ischemic central vein occlusion. And so what about this peripheral non-perfusion? You know, behind diabetes, retinal vein occlusion is the second most common and most prevalent retinal vascular disorder. And although we have pretty good treatment for the posterior pole, that treatment comes with a treatment burden. And so ultra-wide field imaging has helped us classify retinal vein occlusion and perhaps change the way we treat it. In peripheral areas of non-perfusion, imaged on wide-field angiography was treated by Rick Spade. And he really wanted to develop a method to quantify these areas. Here's another patient. If you really just look at the traditional imaging, perhaps you may not even classify this patient as an ischemic CRVO. but this patient indeed does have an ischemic central vein occlusion. Once again, there's ischemia out in the periphery in all four quadrants, not just perhaps the temporal quadrant that we may notice on clinical exam or traditional fluorescein angiography. And you can see these areas here between the non-perfused retina and the perfused retina, and perhaps some early neovascularization in that boundary that we described previously. And you can see once again here the peripheral ischemia that's associated with this hemiretinal vein occlusion, and perhaps not all that normal, even superiorly, in this patient who just happened to knock out the inferior aspect. At these boundaries of the ischemic retina and a non-ischemic retina, these vessels are already changing. These vessels are not normal. They're right-angle vessels, and perhaps some early neovascularization is starting. This patient is in trouble. This patient will likely need more than just anti-VEGF therapy, which addresses the vision and, of course, is paramount importance to the patient. And so when Rick looked at his patients, what he concluded was angiographic mapping of the retina is possible using his image processing techniques and wide field imaging. So if you take wide field imaging, you can really take a look and get a sense of what that ischemic burden is in these patients with central vein occlusion. And this peripheral ischemia may have important implications for visual function. When we go one step further in this ischemia, my colleague Dr. Hari Prasad touched on the ischemic index. And the ischemic index is sort of an important corollary to what we used to do in terms of the number of disc diameters or disc areas of non-perfusion. But in this case, it's a little bit more quantifiable. And what Steve and his colleagues did was they looked retrospectively at patients with retinal vein occlusion, and they looked at the areas of traditional retinal imaging, whether that's the 7 standard fields or even the 60 degrees, and then look beyond with the Optos optomap. And they characterized the areas of ischemia versus the areas of the complete retina that was imaged and the areas of perfusion. And so instead of sort of ballparking how many areas when you count the disc diameter or disc area, you actually get a number that's an index that may help correlate the visual prognosis and may help guide the way you treat the patient and the way you follow the patient. And so in his conclusion in this first paper, what Steve Schwartz really saw was that in patients with non-perfusion, ultra-wide field imaging is really essential to provide that complete area of non-perfusion. And in eyes with neovascularization on the day of angiogram, their ischemic index was much different than the eyes that didn't have neovascularization. So already the pathophysiology of what is going on is being changed by what we're seeing with the wide-field fluorescein angiogram. Now, if you look at the fellow eyes of patients, and we talked about some of the findings that we're determining, you know, using wide-field imaging that we really haven't thought about. Well, in this particular study, once again out of Steve Schwartz's lab, he looked at fellow eyes of 81 patients who had branch retinal vein occlusion. And he wanted to see if there's anything going on in the fellow eyes, because we know that patients don't just wake up one day and have normal blood vessels in the eye and then get up the next day and have abnormal blood vessels. It's a process. It's a process that, as we know, is often influenced by high blood pressure and other factors. And so when you look at the fellow eyes, what you see is that there are findings in the fellow eyes of these patients who have a retinal vein occlusion. You can see, of course, this is one extreme example of a patient with a supratemporal branch retinal vein occlusion, very large branch-retinal vein occlusion. There's peripheral leakage in areas of ischemia and non-perfusion in the fellow eye. We know that patients with vein occlusion, whether that's branch or central, are vasculopaths. These are the people that have systemic disorders. And just like they have systemic disorders, our patients in the fellow eyes do have findings that may become important. This patient, although this is speculation, may be at increased risk for developing another vascular occlusion in their fellow eye. And that risk may be very different if there was no finding on angiogram and the wide field imaging in the fellow eye. Now, all this, of course, really has led to how can this change our treatment? And the way that I consider wide-field imaging is very methodical and scientific. there's the wow factor that we see the whole retina, much more of the retina than we've ever seen before. And in case of branch vein occlusion and central vein occlusion, it's pretty well established now in 2014 that peripheral ischemia plays a role to what's going on posteriorly, and it plays a role to some of the complications that we see, especially in ischemic retinal vein occlusion. The next step, of course, is treatment. And Dave Brown and others are now doing a prospective trial where patients are getting the anti-VEGF therapy because that's still first line, but they're also getting treatment to the periphery to see if that peripheral treatment decreases the treatment burden. Because as we all know, the buzzwords in 2014 for treatment of retinal vein occlusion is decreasing that treatment burden. And it's not only the DAVE and the WAVE trial, but it's also the SCORE 2 trial. As we remember, the SCORE 1 trial used steroids in the treatment of central and branch vein occlusion. In the SCORE 2 trial, they're going to be using ultra-widefield imaging to guide that treatment because the importance of what's going on in the periphery is now recognized, especially in retinal vein occlusion. And so to sort of go back to the first slide that I put up, is there any utility in looking beyond the posterior pole in patients with retinal vein occlusion, especially in the era where we use anti-VEGF and OCT as our primary guiding factor? Well, I hope that I was able to convince you that in a diagnosis, prognosis, and perhaps treatment, and most importantly, follow-up of these patients, the peripheral retina is almost as important as the posterior pole. Thank you again for the invitation. It's a pleasure to be here.